Hi, my name is Tim Barfoot, and I'm delighted to have been invited to give this IROS 2021 keynote talk. I'm a little sad, though, that we have to deliver it virtually, given that Prague is a city that I've always wanted to visit. The title of my talk today is Keeping an Eye on Things. Can we build a long-term navigation system based on vision? I was delighted and surprised to learn that I've been working on robotics for 30 years as I was putting these slides together. And I thought I'd show a few of my past projects. Back in high school, I thought robotics was a lot about mechanical design, and I rushed ahead and built this mobile manipulator that was probably overcomplicated. In grad school, I learned that control has a lot to do with robotics and did some fun projects on multi-robot control and learning to get robots to walk using reinforcement learning. At the end of grad school, though, I was a little worried that I was going to be able to find a job, given that mobile robotics was not the hot topic that it is today. Fortunately, we have a great company here in Canada that built the manipulators for the space shuttle and the space station, and I was lucky to get a job working in R&D there, and I worked on these fun projects on space exploration and mining. And it was there that I got to learn about field robotics and start to get involved in sensor-based navigation of robots. At the time, I remember looking at these top two videos and thinking, wow, this mechanical chassis is very capable, but our sensor-based navigation algorithms aren't really able to fully exploit that capability. And I suppose thinking back 20 years now, I still think that today. In 2007, I got my faculty job, and I've been working on algorithms for field robots ever since. There's one problem, though, that stuck with me over the years and that kind of haunts me. I thought it would be very easy to get a robot to navigate from point A to point B using purely vision. But when you start to think about that in the context of all possible environments, the problem is actually pretty difficult. And I remember being at ICRA 2004, and I watched this talk by Andrew Howard called Multi-Robot Mapping Using Manifold Representations. And it was at a time where many of us were focused on SLAM and trying to build large, globally consistent maps using robots. And Andrew Howard argued that even before we make the map globally consistent, we can still use it to get a robot to navigate along the same paths that it's been along before. And this was a real eye-opener for me, and this idea has kind of stuck with me over the years. We've used this idea in my group to build a set of algorithms for getting robots to visually navigate along paths. And it's one of the sets of algorithms that allows a robot to actually drive in a very limited sense autonomously, almost up to the limit of its mechanical chassis. And here we see a robot driving down some very slippery terrain, but it's sticking in the tracks that it was taught, and it's able to be autonomous because it doesn't need to judge whether that terrain is safe to drive. It just needs to drive the path that it was taught. So, where would path following actually be useful? I actually think it's a key building block that would enable a lot of different mobile robot applications, from self-driving to transportation pods and campus shuttles and off-road applications such as mining, forestry, agriculture, even planetary exploration and search and rescue, maybe even unmanned aerial vehicles. These videos are arranged from, on the left, environments that have the most structure to, on the right, environments that have the least structure. And when answering the question in the title of my talk, can we build a long-term navigation system based on vision, I suppose I'm mostly interested in things that lean towards the right of this spectrum. So I don't really want to have to build navigation algorithms that are highly tailored to the specific semantics of a particular environment. I don't want to exploit the fact that there's roads and traffic lights. I'd like to build a generic building block that works in lots of different environments. My talk also uses the word vision, so why would we want to focus on cameras to solve this problem? A few years ago, I had the opportunity to live in California, and one of my favorite weekend hobbies was spotting all of the self-driving vehicles that were being tested out on the road. And here's just a few pictures from my collection. If you decompose the fancy rigs that they have on these vehicles, they mostly are composed of cameras, LiDARs, and radars in different combinations. In the context of long-term navigation, these sensors are not all equally easy to work with. So here's some data from the same place from all three sensing modalities here in Toronto. And we can see that radar is the least affected by the fact that we've got a change from a sunny to a snowy condition. LiDAR, we see a bit of snow speckle, and cameras are, in fact, highly affected. So although we're going to focus on cameras, we need to go in with eyes open and realize that cameras are probably the most challenging sensor to work with for long-term navigation. But on the other hand, cameras are also ubiquitously available. They're low power, they're low mass, they're cheap, and they're also very high resolution. So if we could crack the camera nut for long-term navigation, it would actually be pretty useful. So I've already given you a motivation for the talk. I'll spend part of the talk summarizing some of our long-term visual navigation work, and then do a deep dive on some recent work where we've been using deep learning to learn features to make visual path following easier. And I'll summarize with an outlook and some future work. So as I said, we've been working on this visual path following idea for quite a while. We've developed a framework that we call Visual Teach and Repeat, or VTNR for short. And it's a navigation algorithm that is designed to let a robot operate in pretty much most unstructured environments using only vision. It works in a teach and repeat kind of manner. And so the idea is you would go to a new environment, such as this mining environment, and there might be a set of paths that we want the robot to operate on. So with single demonstrations of each path segment, we would drive the robot around on all of these paths, and we would store visual information in a map structure. At repeat, then, we should use this map structure to be able to automatically repeat any of these paths as many times as we like, hopefully indefinitely. This framework is pretty efficient. It only requires minimal sensing in terms of one stereo camera, one laptop, and as I said, only one training example of each path segment in our network. It's lightweight in that it does not, in its basic form, require GPS, IMUs, DNNs and their hardware acceleration, global maps, or semantics and structure. It's composable in the sense that we can take the demonstration paths and recombine them into previously undriven combinations so that we can drive anywhere on this graph of paths. And finally, I think of it as a nice framework for enabling lifelong learning. Because we're repeating paths many times, this means we can collect a lot of data along these paths and then hopefully use that data within a machine learning context to improve various components within the autonomy stack, such as localization and mapping, planning, and control. So what are the core ingredients that would go into this visual teach and repeat framework? We clearly didn't create this thing in a vacuum. We're building on a lot of existing work in the literature, starting with the basic idea of just putting cameras on robots. And so we've been doing that in robotics since the 1960s, in the time of Shakey and the Stanford cart. And I love this video of the Stanford cart, where it's moving its camera sideways mechanically in order to determine depth. We also rely heavily on the visual odometry pipeline, so the idea of estimating motion just from imagery. And this builds on the work of Hans Moravec, the PhD thesis of Larry Matthes, much work by Team JPL, and a lot of background work before all of these from bundle adjustment with DC Brown, Waba's problem, Davenport and Horn solutions, Ransack from Fischler and Bowles, features such as Harris Corners, and so on. Another core ingredient is the idea of matchable features. And I can kind of pinpoint that as when David Lowe introduced scale invariant feature transforms, or SIFT, in 1999. And so in matchable features, what I mean is features that we can match purely based on appearance, not just using geometry. And these features were imported, if you like, into robotics, I believe through the work of Stephen See, David Lowe, and Jim Little through their paper that I list there from 2002. And I had the good fortune to work with Stephen at MDA when I was working on those R&D projects that I mentioned. Another key ingredient in VTNR is the idea of local map or relative map representations. So in robotics, we can talk about different types of maps, metric maps that are globally consistent, topological maps that just have places and their connectivity but not distances, and a hybrid of the two, which are sometimes called topometric maps. And it's these this middle representation that we essentially make use of in BTNR, the idea of local metric accuracy, but throwing away global accuracy. And this, of course, builds on much prior work on representing maps in robotics, starting probably with the work of Ben Kuipers with the spatial semantic hierarchy, and many others that I'm not going to read, but some of them are listed there on the screen. I particularly like this quote from Rodney Brooks' 1985 ICRA paper, Visual Map Making for a Mobile Robot. I'll just read the quote. "We use no global or absolute coordinate system. We do not ignore errors, nor do we use beacons or inertial navigation systems. Instead, we will use only local coordinate systems with relative transforms and error estimates." And although I hadn't read this paper when we first built the VTNR system, looking back on it, this is essentially what we've implemented. So let's get into the details of what these maps look like. This triangle on screen represents a robot's pose. And the robot, through its, say, stereo camera, may observe a couple of landmarks, these circles. And then the robot moves and reobserves these landmarks. And from these various measurements, we can infer the motion and try to write down a transform that captures the motion from one pose to another, the relative pose change, as well as some associated uncertainty. So that's basically what visual odometry does. The extra thing we do in VTNR is that we store the landmarks that we just used to estimate motion, but we store them relative to the first pose from which they were seen. And so our map structure is entirely relative, the relative pose transforms and the relative landmark positions. As the robot moves through the environment, we continue to run VO and store these landmarks. And the result is a relative map structure like the one you see here. We do all of that during the teach pass. At repeat, we're now going to let the live camera image be represented by this red triangle here, and our goal is to know where we are relative to the path that we want to drive. We can reobserve some of the landmarks that are in the map and therefore infer the relative pose between the live image and the path that we've stored. We also run visual odometry in the live stream of images so that if we don't happen to match any landmarks for a while, we still know where we are. And then hopefully a little bit later, we reobserve some landmarks so that we can correct our estimate and know where we are accurately with respect to the path. Once we know where we are, we can also look forward ahead along the path and see what shape it has, and then run something like model predictive control to come up with the inputs in order to zero any errors that we might have. So that's a repeat. And we can build up this relative map structure over a very large area and through an interconnected set of paths. So if you were to zoom into any one of these path segments in this 5-kilometer network of paths, it would look like what I showed you on the left. Now, the map I just showed you had loops, and I only really told you how to build maps for single paths. So how do we handle loops? It turns out in relative map structures, loops are almost trivially handled. You could imagine teaching one of these paths and our VO estimates that we come around the loop like this, but because it's drifted, it's not perfect, these might actually be the same physical place, although we don't think that they are in terms of our pose estimate. However, we've only stored relative transforms, and if we happen to know that this is the same place, we can just tell the robot that it's back in the same place. We can insert an edge and apply an identity transform to that edge. And really, that's it. We're done with mapping. We don't need to run a large, expensive optimization over the map to make it globally consistent. We can actually just use it the way it is right now. When we do this for real on the robot, here's a view of our user interface. We might come around a loop and come back to a place where we want to actually deliberately force a loop closure. We want the path to connect back into one of our previous paths. And we can do that by indicating to the robot that we expect a loop closure, drive back into our tracks from another part of the path, tell the robot to look for a loop closure, and it can find the visually most similar appearance, and then insert one of these identity transforms. And although you saw the graph optimize in the user interface, that's just for the benefit of the user. Under the hood, we're still using this relative map structure. And so that structure, I come to think of it as a lot like the Escher staircase. We have local metric accuracy, and if you look at any part of this loop, it makes sense. but globally, the transforms are not going to add up to identity around the loop. It turns out that just doesn't matter for being able to drive a robot around. We don't need to make the map globally consistent in order to drive on it. So going back to Andrew Howard's idea. And another key part of this is when we start using cameras with these relative map structures to drive around outside, of course, things like lighting and weather start to change, and this makes it really challenging in order to match things. So our matchable features start to break down as we start to drive around in everything from, you know, springtime with green vegetation to nighttime in a snowstorm with our headlights on. And so the question is, how can we get around this difficult appearance change? We've tried a lot of different things over the years to kind of improve our ability to match, and I'm going to come back to that in the second part of the talk. But the thing that really, I think, gives us the most leverage on this problem is what I'm going to describe next. So imagine now you've taught a path in daylight, and you're trying to repeat it at some other lighting condition that's quite different. And, you know, it could be something as benign looking as these two videos. So on the left, we have some images from a teach pass, and on the right from a repeat that's about 7 hours later and the sun has moved across the sky. In this case, we're using surf features, and for certain sections along this path, we get good feature matches and we can estimate relative pose. But at other sections, we just don't have enough features to reliably estimate the pose. And then we're kind of dead. And so the thing that I think has provided the most leverage on this problem, well, what if we didn't actually wait 7 hours to drive the path? What if we drove the path sooner, perhaps 3 hours later? If we didn't drive so far into the future, if it was only a 3 hours difference, perhaps there would be enough features to match reliably all the way along the path. And this builds very heavily on the work of my good friends Winston Churchill and Paul Newman at the Oxford Group and their experience-based navigation. And there's a bunch of follow-on works that I list here on the screen. The version that we ended up building is called multi-experience localization. And the idea then, of course, is if we can drive more frequently, we don't need to directly match the live experience back to the teach pass. We could maybe match live to this bridging experience and then bridging back to teach pass, and therefore know still metrically where we are, actually this pose, the live image, where that pose is relative to here by chaining through the bridging experience. And we can have as many of these as we like, as often as we want to drive, actually. So here's an example with four bridging experiences. And you can see in the images on the left that we're getting, by color code, matches in the live image back to all of the other experiences that we have in the map. And this actually looks good enough that we can teach a path in daylight, continue to drive as the sun is going down, and then be driving still in our tracks at nighttime with our headlights turned on. And there are no direct matches from nighttime to daytime, but by chaining through all the intermediate experiences, we can metrically know where we are. So putting that together, we've been working on this visual path following system and been able to drive across pretty severe changes in lighting and weather. We've deployed this on a lot of different robots over the last 15 or so years. You can see some of them here. We've even taken the code and given it to some of our partners to test and shake out some of the problems and give us feedback. And I'm delighted to use this talk today to actually formally announce that we've just completed a year-long overhaul of the VTNR codebase, and we're open sourcing for the first time Visual Teach and Repeat 3. So you can find that on GitHub right now. The link is there. It's based on ROS 2. There are versions that work with stereo camera, as I've been talking about, but also a version that works on LiDAR point clouds. We're in the process of building a version that has radar as the key sensor, but that's not available yet. And I just want to do a shout out to our friends and colleagues at Defense Research and Development Canada. Their video is in the bottom right of this montage. They've been great at helping us shake out the bugs in this latest version of VTNR3. And so you can see their ROS2 enabled robot driving around with the VTNR3 codebase there in the bottom right. Okay, so we've got an idea of what visual path following is all about. Well, one of the advantages of this framework that I mentioned earlier is the idea that it's possibly an enabler for lifelong learning in robotics. And the reason that is the case is that when the robot drives and repeats the path many times, we actually end up gathering a lot of new data about the environment, lots of different ways that environments can look to the sensors. Of course, whenever you have lots of data, you start to think about, well, what could I do with that data? What are the learning opportunities that I could try to avail myself of? We've done a number of different things, everything from trying to learn better control, so thinking about multiple repeats of paths and looking at our path tracking errors and analyzing those to try to improve our control, to improving our terrain assessment, so looking at how the sensors see different environments. Think about tall grass and trying to decide whether it's safe to drive through tall grass. We can measure, as it's swaying around, different geometries of that grass and then compare our live geometry and see if it's significantly different from what we've seen on the successful repeats that we've had in the past and decide whether it's safe to drive. Even at the network of paths level, we can gather statistics around how often we were able to successfully drive different segments of the path without the vision system having problems, for example. And then we can cast routing through this network of paths, to my great delight, as something called the Canadian Traveler problem. And we can solve some interesting routing problems to build policies for robust traversals through these graphs. And perhaps most important, we can use all of this data that we gather to try to improve our localization. And I'm going to spend a bit more time talking about that in depth. So I made a big song and dance about this idea of using bridging experiences in order to sort of get across the appearance gap. But really, now that we have all of this data, isn't there something we could do to try to directly match daytime to nighttime? Could we do something clever with that to learn? And maybe even more challenging is, could we actually get across season gaps and other types of appearance change as well? So could we match this teach pass image to any of these other repeats directly without any bridging experiences? So learning better localization is a very hot topic in robotics over the last years. Even before learning, I just want to mention this work that was started in robotics by Peter Cork and the Oxford group around the idea of using color constant imagery to try to get around some of the problems that come with lighting change with cameras. So by combining red, green, and blue channels in a clever way, you can build images that are more representative of the underlying material properties of what you're looking at rather than the effect of illumination on those materials. So you can remove shadows, for example. And this actually works really well within the sort of daytime operational envelope to improve matching, even with any type of features. Some other really fun work that I like that came out of Tom Krajnik and Tom Duckett's groups was the idea of evolving the descriptors of some of the existing features. In particular, their grief features looked at evolving the descriptors for brief features. So you can see the descriptor in the center. And the idea is, given that you're getting some parts of that descriptor to match, you can try to prune out the parts that are not useful and introduce new parts that could actually be useful for matching. And we had some good success with this, again, sort of within the daytime operational envelope for improving our feature matching. Other fun work coming out of Oxford, again, where they built place-specific landmarks as learned classifiers, their scene signature work. And the idea there was, given several traversals of an environment, you could take image patches to build landmarks and take examples of how those patches have looked under different lighting and weather to build a classifier to determine if a new observation of a patch would match to that or not. And that was quite robust. Across different lighting and weather. Turning now to deep learning approaches, there have been a few different ways of thinking about using deep learning to improve localization. So Lee Clement and John Kelly put out the paper How to Train a Cat, which stands for Canonical Appearance Transformation. And the idea there is to build a network that can take images under different, say, lighting conditions and try to transform them back to some canonical lighting conditions, such as daytime. And they had some good success in trying to do that through fairly interesting lighting change, although we haven't seen it work directly across the daytime-nighttime gap yet. Another way that we can think about deep learning is to not just evolve existing descriptors, but to actually come up with whole new descriptors that would be more robust against lighting and weather change. So some early work around this in robotics by Nick Carlevaris and Bianco and Ryan Eustace, where they were using data from stationary webcams available on the internet to try to learn features that would be robust against lighting and weather change. And that worked pretty interestingly, or worked quite well, I should say. The holy grail, perhaps, with using deep learning for better localization is the idea of just regressing pose directly. Could we train a network that could take two images and then just output the relative pose change between them? The PoseNet paper, many may have heard of that, did exactly this. They were able to train a network that could do this, but the precision is sort of not what we require in visual teach and repeat. We need to sort of get down to the 1 centimeter and fractions of a degree level. And we haven't seen that actually happen in a direct pose regressor yet that's also robust against severe lighting and weather change. So given all of this amazing prior work, we could put up a learning spectrum and we could ask, where is the best place for learning to help us? We could regress pose like PoseNet on the far left in an end-to-end framework, or we could do no learning and just handcraft everything. And I suppose after trying a few different things, we're sort of settled now on somewhere in the middle where we can use deep learning to learn front-end features and exploit all of the benefits there in unraveling these complicated rich sensing problems. And then combine that with a classic backend where we can do trajectory estimation and exploit all of our standard tools there, most importantly, outlier rejection. So given that we're matching features using deep learning, we know there are going to be mistakes. So of course, we want to make use of some form of outlier rejection to be robust to those mistakes. Speaking specifically about this idea now of deep learning features, there have been quite a flurry of papers over the last couple of years. GNMet, deja vu features, this relocalization paper that combined a few different techniques, back to the future, unsuperpoint. These are great names. I need to come up with better names. And under the radar. And this one is a bit different in that it didn't use cameras. This was great work by Dan Barnes and Ingmar Posner at Oxford, where they were using the fact that they had ground truth pose between radar images, and they were able to then backpropagate through a differentiable pose estimator to learn features that they could match radar images with in the context of localization. And we were quite inspired by this work. So using this under the radar paper and some of the other network architecture ideas, we kind of tried to apply this to cameras. So I'm gonna do now a bit of a deep dive on a paper that my PhD student and I, Simona Gridseth and I, submitted to ICRA recently called Keeping an Eye on Things, Deep Learned Features for Long-Term Visual Localization. So as I said, we were quite inspired by the Under the Radar paper, and so we set out to try to repeat this idea using cameras to see if we could build features that were robust against lighting and weather change. And so the idea with our training pipeline is that we take two images, we're going to train a network that outputs some key points, some scores, which tell us sort of where in the image is it good to look for features and to weight the features, and some descriptors. We match those in a differentiable way, we put them through an inverse stereo camera model to come up with 3D key points, and then we put these through a differentiable pose estimator to come up with a relative pose. So you could think of this as a pose estimation pipeline. Now, critically, we only learn this part of this pipeline. So we're only going to learn the neural network that actually tries to come up with the key points, the scores, and the descriptors. The rest we're going to assume is known and differentiable. So we have all of these, and they're going to be differentiable. And then in the context of visual teach and repeat, the nice thing is because we've been driving using our multi-experience localization, we can have relative pose information between images that we actually can't directly match, but we can use the fact that we've used our multi-experience framework to come up with these relative pose labels. And once we have that, we can backpropagate through the whole pipeline in order to try to train the network features over here. The loss we use is on the final pose, and also on, we have an intermediate loss on the key points, and I'll refer you to Mona's paper for the details there. Once we've trained the features, the network for the features, I should say, we throw away this part of the pipeline. We don't actually use this online for visual path following. So in a sense, this differential pose estimator was only used as a fixture or a jig in order to train the network to extract the features. Really what we want to do is then take these features and put them into our already existing state estimation pipeline within Visual Teach and Repeat, which could use multi-experience, but probably will now just try single experience because we're going to be better at matching. But we get the benefit of outlier rejection and the fact that we're running visual odometry in the live stream of images in order to have a prior on our pose change. The network architecture is something like this, fairly standard. It's got an encoder-decoder structure, but we've got two heads. The first head is outputting the key points, and the second head is outputting these scores that I mentioned. You can see an example here of scores, brighter meaning that part of the image is probably better for localization. Our descriptors, we take activations from various levels in the encoder to build up a fairly high-dimensional descriptor. And so the network outputs these three things, the descriptor, the key points, and the scores. To train these features, we've seen a few of these videos already in the talk, but we have a data set called the UTIAS Long-Term Localization and Mapping data set that's publicly available. And it's got two main components, an in-the-dark component where we had a loop around this dome structure that we drove about 40 times over the course of a single day through all different lighting conditions. And another loop called the multi-season loop, where we, over the course of 3 months, did over 100 repeats through all these different weather and lighting conditions, including snowstorms at night. And so the nice thing is, because we gathered all of this data using, we actually gathered all the data autonomously, other than the teach passes of these two loops, we are able to get the ground truth labels using our multi-experience localization version of Visual Teach and Repeat. And then we'll use that to train the features. So since we have the ground truth labels from gathering the data already, we can take any two random images within our spatiotemporal pose graph, and we know the relative pose change between them. And so we can basically use that as a training example for our pipeline. So we'll take one of these, build a mini batch, and then do a stochastic gradient descent update on the network that extracts the features. And if we do this a lot, hopefully we're going to train features that can match things that look really different. So I'm going to describe a couple of experiments that are in Mona's paper. The first one, we only use the in-the-dark portion of the the long-term localization data set. And you can see the different conditions there. So we use that data to train these features, as I just described. And then we taught a new path. So remember, the training data is from 2016, 5 years ago. We taught a new path this year in 2021 that's very similar in where it was taught, although it's not an identical path, but it's 5 years later. And so the idea was, could we then use the features from the data that we just learned, sorry, the features that we just learned from the data in order to repeat this path 5 years later? And we taught a path in daylight, and then repeated it again across all lighting conditions from dark to daytime to nighttime again. And it turns out we were successful in doing that. We were able to drive the path in all the different lighting conditions, even though the teach pass was in daylight. And anecdotally, it looks like this. So over on the left, we see the features that are being matched in the condition that's being displayed back to directly, without the use of multi-experience localization, back to directly the daylight experience. So everything from fog to nighttime to overcast to sunny. And we can see there are lots of features being matched almost all the time. So this is pretty promising. And over here we see on the right the different conditions the robot was driving in. We turned the headlights on at night, by the way. So we saw what it looked like qualitatively. Quantitatively, we've got some fun results here. So on the left, we've got a plot of the average number of matched features on a given run versus the time of day of that run, of that repeat run. So we taught the path in daylight and then repeated it from dark to midday back to dark. We can see the number of features that we match sort of degrades gracefully off to the sides, depending on how different the repeat condition was from the teach condition in the daytime. And even here in the worst case, which was fog in the dark with headlights on, we're still getting on average over 100 features matching back to the daylight experience directly. So this was a big step forwards for us. We're definitely not able to do that using any of the handcrafted features that we've used before. And so deep learning has actually solved this problem reasonably well for us. I should also say that across almost 40 repeats, there were only four frames, not four runs, four individual images that failed to have enough features to localize back to the daylight condition. So that's out of many thousands of images. Only four didn't have enough features. On the right, we see some other important information. So we superimposed the RTK GPS tracks of all of these repeats, so very high precision GPS, and we were able to show that we only have an average cross-track lateral path tracking error of 4.9 centimeters. So comparing all of the repeats back to the original teach pass, we only had just under a 5 centimeter path tracking error, which is very small compared to the size of the robot. And again, all of these repeats were done 100% autonomously. The second experiment, we tried to push the envelope a little bit more. So we used all of the data from the long-term localization dataset from 2016 to train features. And then we tested on a slightly more ambitious path. And this time we taught a path that was a bit longer, but also that it went into a couple of areas that were not in common with the areas where the training data was gathered. So we were trying to test whether the features would generalize from one area to another area. We were able to teach a path in daylight again, and we were able to repeat the path across all lighting conditions again with 100% autonomy rate. Anecdotally, it looks like this. So we've got features displayed on some video of a part of the path that's in one of the new sections, so that's distinct from where the training data were gathered. And we see again across different lighting conditions that we're getting large numbers of features matched back to the teach pass. Even here in the dark, we're getting enough features to keep driving. And I'll remind you, we're running VO in the live stream, and so we don't actually need to get a lot of features in every frame. We can afford to drive on VO for short distances and then rematch against the map. You can see the conditions the robot was driving in over here on the right. Again, quite different from daytime to nighttime with headlights. Quantitatively, the results for experiment two look like this. Again, we have the average number of features per run versus the time of day of that repeat run. The path was taught in daytime, and we drove from dark to dark. We see again the number of features dropping off as the condition is more different from the teach pass, maybe dropping off a little bit more as we go into the nighttime section here. But again, there were enough features. This is still quite a few features. We only need a few tens of features to match reliably, and we don't need those in every frame. So this is good enough to keep driving in our tracks through all of these repeats. We also dug into the data just a little bit more deeply to see how well our features generalize from the training part of the area to the new parts. So in this plot over here, we're looking at the number of features in the training part of this road section to the new part of the road section. The training part is in blue, the new part is in orange. And we see the number of features stays pretty much the same from the training area to the new testing area. Again, for the other part over here in the woods, we compared the number of features we got in the training area to the new part of the loop. So the training area is in blue, the new part is in orange, and this time we see there is actually a drop in the number of features. So we can see that right here. And you know, perhaps this is to be expected. We didn't use a lot of data to train these features, and yet they were still reasonably robust. So we can't expect that they have perfect generalization. There's still some work to be done in perfecting the network architecture, probably putting a lot more data into it to train features that are actually going to be robust across a very large number of environments. But there's a glimmer of hope here. This is something we weren't able to do before, match things from daytime to nighttime and reliably drive. So we're not just doing this on data sets, right? We're actually making robots drive around in the dark, matching back to daytime. And now I just want to take a little bit of a step back and think about sort of holistically what have we seen in this talk. I want to think about the idea of lifelong learning, and I think this is important for robotics and is a bit distinct from machine learning at large. I think for us, we need to come up with ways of getting robots to learn in an efficient way. And this is maybe one example of of a possible path forward for lifelong learning. And I kind of think of it like this. Initially, we have to have a human teach the path for the robot, and really there, the robot is just along for the ride. It's not even in control of its steering. Once we've taught a path, we give the robot some training wheels in the form of multi-experience localization, and then we let the robot, under very strict conditions, repeat the path as long as the conditions are not too different from any conditions it's seen before. But it's still able to do something in a very limited autonomous sense. And so that's still a useful thing, and it can be monitored there. But more importantly, it can use that opportunity to gather data. And then it can do something like we learned about today, where we learn features and potentially learn features that then generalize to new paths, such that we can send the robot, teach it a path in some new environment that's totally different, and then have it still robustly match using cameras across all lighting and weather conditions. So this is just one tiny example of lifelong learning, and you could imagine a curriculum that has many more steps after these. But I think this might be kind of an interesting way to think about it, because there's a small amount of human investment up front, and then most of the work is done by the robot autonomously, even in the learning parts of the problem. Another way that we can think about this is the idea of thinking fast and thinking slow, which is a book by Nobel Prize winning economist Daniel Kahneman. And a big shout out to Ingmar Posner for this analogy and putting me onto this book and how to think about this. Kahneman argues that in the human brain, we actually have two systems. System one, which is intuition and instinct behavior, and system two, which is rational thinking. And maybe we don't really need to choose between these. He says both of these are important. So in the context of our talk today, system two would be more like this very careful multi-experience localization, where we match one thing to another thing and reason through what has to match to what in order to know where we are. System one is we've compiled all of that experience into a deep neural network that is maybe no longer interpretable, but now can operate very quickly and directly without having to do all of this like slow, deliberate thinking. And maybe we don't have to choose. Maybe the right solution is to have both of these systems running in our robots. So I'm going to start to wrap up now. I talked about our long-term efforts around visual path following in the form of this visual teach and repeat. You can download it and try it out for yourself. It's open source on GitHub. It works with stereo cameras. I would encourage you to give it a try. It's got the multi-experience localization version, so even across lighting and weather change, you can start to get the robot to continue to drive. We also have that data set that I mentioned on long-term localization and mapping, so you can play around with that if you don't have a robot. And we use that to try to train these features that I talked about to try to directly match through difficult lighting conditions. Obviously, there's lots of next steps, and I don't have a final answer to the question that I posed in the title of can we build a long-term navigation system based on vision, but I'm starting to think that we can, and I think some of the progress around trying to combine deep learning with classic techniques is really sort of the way forward for trying to do this. I didn't talk about it, but we also have the LiDAR version of Teach and Repeat that's available, and we're building out the radar version, so that'll have to be left to a different talk. I'll just finally close out with a couple other ideas that we've been pursuing. I mentioned that we don't require GPS to make this visual path following work, but given that it exists and that it's fairly inexpensive to process GPS measurements once you have them, how could we make use of those in VTNR? So we put out this paper earlier this year called Relatively Lazy, Indoor-Outdoor Navigation Using Vision and GNSS. And the idea there was to have GPS and use it in a relative sense that doesn't corrupt our relative map structure, but allows us to keep following paths when vision fails to match. And then the neat thing about that is it's another set of training wheels, right? If we can follow the path using GPS, we can still be recording the features that we've seen and then maybe use those the next time in order to drive using only vision. The other thing we've been a bit remiss in incorporating into VTNR is local obstacle avoidance. So we have terrain assessment to stop the robot if there are obstructions, but we don't actually deviate from the path to avoid obstacles. And I would like to approach this from, the lifelong learning perspective. I don't want to have to impose any particular structure on, you know, here's a human detector, here's a car detector. I would like the robot to figure out what moves in the environment, what doesn't move, and then try to avoid the things that don't move and maybe don't avoid the things that do move because they're going to move out of the way. And so we've been thinking about this in an indoor navigation framework and hope to bring some of those ideas to our full outdoor framework soon. Local obstacle avoidance within Teach and Repeat is not new. In fact, the PhD thesis of Philip Krusey coming out of Roland Sigwart's lab and this great paper Driving on Point Clouds showed how to do this within the context of a LiDAR point cloud-based version of Teach and Repeat. And then some really neat, interesting work, from Dieter Fox's group around a system that's very similar to Visual Teach and Repeat, where they use demonstrations of robots driving through environments to build up a learned navigation framework. And one of the neat properties of the way they've done this is that local obstacle avoidance, as you see in this video, kind of emerges from how they've learned the control part of the problem. So I'm going to finish there. I, of course, got to do all the talking, and the students, the postdocs, and the collaborators did most of the work. So big thanks out to them. And I've also got to thank all of our amazing sponsors that have supported our work over the years. Thank you so much. Looking forward to the next many years. So thanks very much for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions in the Q&A part of this talk.